Well, praise the Lord, everybody. And thank you again for joining us here at First Baptist Church Denby as we continue our senior week and continue with some pertinent information that we hope is inspiring and motivating our seniors here at First Baptist Church Denby and seniors who are watching us from whatever social media platform that they're watching for. Praise the Lord today. What a beautiful day it is that God has given us. He's woken us up again and got us started on our way. And he's put what they say, pep in our step. He's helping us to form new relations and get closer to him. So we thank God for that. He's an awesome God. God that we cherish and we love and we appreciate. And we thank him for every blessing that he gives us. And no matter what the weather conditions are, no matter what whatever spiritual conditions or social conditions are, we know our God is still God, regardless of external or internal conditions. So we thank him again today. And we have a great speaker for you today, Mr. Tim Joseph, and I'll introduce him to you later on. But right now, I just want to take a moment out for read a scripture and do a prayer, and we'll get right into our service. Just another footnote so you'll know, we're in our program tomorrow at 12. We start at 12 to 1, and we'll end it with lifestyles for seniors. And we have someone talking about lifestyles and things you can do, places you can visit and stuff like that, and exercising and keeping healthy and things like that, and that you may not be aware of, but some things that can help you anyway. And so we thank you again for joining us, and we hope you enjoy our program for today, and I'm pretty sure you will gain a lot from what Mr. Joseph has to say. So make sure you get your pen, your pad, your iPhone if you use that, whatever medium you have to write with. I hope you have that with you today, because there's going to be a lot of information coming your way. Amen. So let me read a scripture for you, and I'm going to switch gears from what I've been reading for the last three Wednesdays. I'm going to use, while reading today, Psalm 27. I'm just going to read a little bit of that. Psalm 27 says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though the host shall encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this will I be confident. One thing have I desired of the Lord, that I will seek after him, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire of his temple. For in the time of trouble he shall hide me, and in his pavilion, in the secret of the tabernacle, shall he hide me. He shall set me upon a rock." Amen. Praise God for that. If you would bow your head with me wherever you are, social media, just bow your head with me as we give a word of prayer. Father God, we thank you again for your loving kindness and your tender mercies. We thank you for being kind to us, being merciful. We thank you for watching over us as we slept last night and finding us faithful enough to give us another day of your glorious sunshine. We thank you, Lord, for the day that we have. We thank you for the privilege of the day. And we pray, God, that you would allow us to use the day that we have to not only help ourselves to become healthier and wiser and better, but also let us use this day in order to lift up somebody else's spirit, to help somebody else, to add value to somebody else's life. We thank you for this program today. We ask that you bless Mr. Tim Joseph as he comes to deliver a word to our congregation and to those who are listening on social media. We thank you for him, and we praise God that he was able to come to be with us today. So we thank you, Lord, for all those who are listening to us today. We ask a special blessing upon our seniors as we honor them and give them the credit that they do, give them their flowers while they are living. And so we thank you for them. We ask you to bless every senior under the sound of my voice that's listening right now. And we just just ask you, God, to just be with them, encourage them, and let them know that you will never leave them nor forsake them, that you're always by their side. And so we thank you, we give you praise, we give you glory, and we give you honor. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. And if you can, say wherever you are, just say amen. Amen. We're going to introduce our speaker for the day. I've already given you his name, Mr. Tim Joseph. And for many of us who are here at First Baptist Church Denby, he is no stranger. He's been in our midst for a pretty long time. And he is an officer or advisor or financial advisor with First Command Financial Center. And he's coming with us today to discuss some financial matters. He gives his contact information later on today. He's a retired military, by the way, 20 years in the military, and he's taken that military experience to use and to help other military members to become financially stable and help them with some type of sustainability in financial matters. And so we're glad to have him today. And as I said, he'll talk about financial management and wellness and living beyond retirement, investment opportunities, and things of that nature. So without further ado, I introduce to some and present to others Mr. Tim Joseph, a financial command and a financial advisor from that firm. Amen. Hear you him.
Thank you very much, Pastor. Thank you very much. It has just been a warm, warm welcome, and I'm so blessed to be here today. And thank you so much for the warm invitation. Certainly, anytime that we can come together in the house of the Lord, that's a good day. I want to particularly express my appreciation to Deacon Linwood Wright, who is, again, a servant chosen by God, who offered me the opportunity to come here and speak with the seniors. It has been my experience in financial planning that the most important thing about any undertaking is being able to share and be honest and be truthful. Because until we know what the problem is, we can't begin to even diagnose or give you a solution. So what I'm going to do today is offer you some short but very hopefully impactful options. And the title of this particular presentation is Overcoming Money Challenges When Retired. I would be leading you astray if I told you that every client that I speak with is prepared for retirement, even in retirement, because life happens and things will occur that are unexpected, whether it's medical, it could be the loss of a spouse, or there are all kinds of things. Certainly in COVID, there are all sorts of challenges that have changed the paradigm of being successful and being able to maintain financial stability. Therefore, let's look at some things that we have found to be successful for those that may find challenges. So let's go to our next slide here. So my number one recommendation, if you find yourself in a predicament, is to seek help. And you seek help for someone that you truly can trust. As a senior, you may have children. At this point, they may be adult children. But don't make it a secret. Sit down with them and have a very honest heart to heart discussion about your situation. What you'll find is that the ability just to share that information, the opportunity to just to share that is liberating. At that point, when you sit down with that child, go through what your expenses are. Go through what your challenges are. And it is not uncommon to have that opportunity to come up with solutions that could end up resulting in downsizing or making some lifestyle changes to allow you to, again, to survive and to get on your feet or to put yourself in a better position. If you don't have any children or that's an option that you choose not to do, then there are other family members. And in the United States today, there are many multi-generational and hybrid sorts of family situations that happen because it's a matter of getting together and pooling assets and making sure that those can survive. Other family could also include, in this case, your church family or a group family. This is the first step here in trying to, again, elicit honest assessments so that we can see how we can best help and make your situation better. On the other area, there are people such as myself, which are financial advisors. These are individuals who have absolute neutrality and have no stake in your situation. Therefore, we are able to give you a straight-up, unvarnished impression of what your situation is and what we feel, based on years and years of experience, have worked and been successful for others. Every one of us, certainly around this time of year, it's tax season. There are some excellent, excellent advantages and opportunities, tax credits for seniors. So if the family member or financial advisor is not available, then there's certainly tax professionals that are able to provide you some of the real keys and advantages for seniors, particularly those over 65. One excellent area and one excellent organization in Newport News is the Peninsula Agency on Aging. Please make yourself familiar with them. They are in, you can Google, or they are easily available online. You can find them out. But they offer a multitude of programs designed for seniors, whether it's coping financially, medically, physically. It is an excellent, excellent, excellent vehicle to be able to share and receive assistance in your situation. So as I move from here again, if you first find yourself having difficulties, reach out and get help, because there are all kind of people that are available that want to assist you. Now let's move to the next slide. I say this, and we are in the United States, and I was doing a bit of research and wondering which country has the highest income. Most of us believe that the United States, if you listen to whomever is speaking, that we are the most richest country in the world. Well, we actually are number six in terms of total income. The European countries, Norway, Sweden, they have almost a 10% higher income per capita than those of us in the U.S. However, there are some very, very, very rich countries like Spain that the average income is $21,000 a year, which is, again, barely over $1,800 a month. So the first thing is, when we look at your situation, it really isn't as bad as you may think it is. We just have to be able to take a look and, again, establish a game plan or process to make life better for you. But in my experience, the most important asset or resource is something that's not financial. It's health. Because there is, if you are able to maintain some degree of health, then that makes the job a whole lot easier. I rate this as the most precious resource that you have. Again, I know all sorts of people with all kinds of money with poor health, and they all say that they would trade every dime in order to get better health, because you can't buy that. If it comes to finances, stress, we concern ourselves with, oh, how am I going to pay this? How am I going to pay that? And the stress can be enormous. My experience, every situation is temporary. It's just a matter of having the faith and the courage to persevere, to seek the help, and work through the situation. Again, tomorrow you'll have a professional or someone that will come in to discuss what sort of physical activities and what sort of things to keep yourself well. And that's really the key. If you can be active, if you can focus on the things that you can control, that will help you to better deal with the issues and the problems and the stress that may come about. The last thing here I want to say here, what's really important? Because it's funny, it's very, very interesting, is that when you boil it down to it and you look at your life, you wonder, why did I spend so much time on things that really, really weren't important? What are the real important things in my life? And those things overwhelmingly don't include money. It's memories, it's time, it's the quality of life. But you have to be present to be able to enjoy those things. Therefore, I believe the first step after sitting down and talking with someone is to focus on those things that you can control, and to keep yourself as healthy as you can doing those things, from a diet, from a rest, from an activity, from an exercise standpoint, that gives you another day to get out and fight the battle. Next slide, please. Now, let's get into kind of the nitty-gritty, and it's probably what we all came here to discuss. If you find yourself having some challenges, let's do an assessment of all of those monetary resources that you have. First, starting with the bank. There is a rule of thumb that us in the financial industry, we must adhere to. And that rule of thumb is that never invest any money that you need within a period less than 5 years. Because if you need it and you invest it and you need it prior to that 5-year point, there's no guarantee that what you put in may be what you get out. Therefore, having a good relationship with a good, strong bank is most important from a financial standpoint, because it is the cash that gives you the ability to take care of immediate things. Banks are liquid organizations where the idea is you're able to go in and immediately take out what you put in without having to go through any brokerage or sales desk or commissions. It's just there and it's available. And so that is the key thing, making sure that you have those resources available to you in case of an emergency or a situation where it's short term. And there are various banks, and each bank has its own particular rules and minimums and requirements, but don't be misled or don't feel trapped, because there are always banks that can cater to what your situation is, as far as whatever expenses or charges that they may want to assess based on the balances that you maintain. They are out there, and again, through that consultation with that family member or that professional, we'll be able to find a solution that will work for you. The next item here is something called an IRA, an individual retirement account. Granted, if you weren't able to open one of these accounts, it is irrelevant to you. But if you do have those, these vehicles are very, very critical and crucial in helping you managing your finances going forward, particularly from a tax standpoint. An individual retirement account is an individual account. Each person has these own accounts based on their own situation, and you're able to use those tax-deferred or tax-free depending on the nature of that IRA. We would, again, want to take a look at that, see if we have it invested or organized in such a way that will provide you the sustainability and the longevity for you to reach whatever the goal that you need from a financial standpoint. The next financial vehicle is an annuity. An annuity, again, these products can be very, very beneficial, particularly for a person that is on a set income or requires a set amount of predictable resources coming in. They, you know, you will hear all sorts of language and all sorts of information that promote the benefits of these as well as those that don't. Again, this will be something that is individual and something that would be relevant to your situation to look at, well, what are you trying to accomplish and how does this product help you to accomplish those things. Again, a very useful tool, misunderstood, so this is something that definitely requires some assistance if you don't understand what are the advantages, disadvantages, or the benefits that you could achieve. Also important are the amount of debts that you have. This is, a lot of focus with regard to what types of debts, whether they are from credit cards, mortgages, cars, personal loans. All of those have to be evaluated. And you have to have the fortitude to allow yourself to sit down, lay those out in their entirety. What is the amount that's owed per pay period or per cycle? What is the rate of interest? What's the total balance? What is the time frame it would take for you to pay those off completely? The approach to debts are not all the same. And in some cases, it's better to manage those instead of you have the ability to pay off the debts and you pay all those. Now what happens to the money that you had? So let's be very, very deliberate in evaluating and making a determination of how to discharge debts. Again, there are certainly ways to deal with that, and we'll talk to that in a little on another slide here. So let's go to the next slide, please. Again, we live an entire lifetime. We're in our 60s, 70s, 80s, and we have accumulated all kinds of things. Wow. At some point, things that we're never going to use again, things that, you know, mean very little to our children, because if you really want to know, ask them, hey, do you want this old picture of me at my high school or my old, you know, it's just, and so one of the very first things is to look at it and declutter. One good thing is that because of the nature of the quality of things that a person buys now compared to the quality of things that were made back in the 70s, 80s, 90s, those items actually have value because of the quality they are. And with the proliferation of things like eBay and auctions and so forth, there's lots of opportunity to be made by doing inventory and begin to either declutter by selling or even donating these things that, again, that nobody else other than you feels that it is important. Now, certainly you want to maintain the things that mean the most to you, but maybe not everything. Getting that cleared out then creates more space and gives you the idea or the opportunity to think about, well, hey, what do I really need? What are the things that really, on a daily basis, do I really need to help me to navigate and to operate? I list under the things cars. If you are finding yourself in a financial situation and you have multiple cars, do you really need more than one car or more than one vehicle? Think of all of the costs associated with insurance, maintenance, etc., upkeep. Many, many families, particularly seniors, will go down to one vehicle. It's easier to maintain, and it gives, again, it provides them the opportunity to focus on that and not necessarily be distracted or impacted by something major or something that comes up unexpectedly. And when we speak about things, again, we have all kinds of things that are meaningless. At this point, let's take a good look and a thing that whatever is most important.
That's 1, 2, 3. That's 1, 2.
There we go.
That's 1, 2. No, it's not. That's 1, 2. I need to turn it up. That's 1, 2. That's 1, 2. That's 1, 2.
1, 2.
1, 2. 1, 2. Maybe just hold this one. How about that?
Okay.
Testing 1, 2.
Okay, here we go. So thank you for being patient with us as we work through this challenge. And it's funny because if you were to speak with my wife or anyone that knows me, the last problem that you would have with me is not being able to hear me because I talk so loud. So let's, again, we're talking about decluttering, but again, very important. There are a number of seniors in this area with the colleges and the universities nearby to find that they may have too much house. And so there are opportunities available to maybe, in clearing out space, you create a living space for a student in this area that can stay here, and that gives you an opportunity to earn income. So take a good look, do an inventory, donate the things that you can donate that you don't wear or don't use anymore. Also consider selling those, and as you clear our space, you may find that you have an opportunity to provide a service for a student or someone in the area who's looking for lodging. Now let's go to the next slide, please. Very, very important is to review all of your insurance policies. Insurance policies have, in some cases, golden nuggets. Are there all kinds of benefits and features in those policies that can be beneficial? The first is your homeowner's policy. If you, again, doing a thorough review with the insurance agent that is responsible for that policy, because for every insurance policy, there's an agent associated with that policy. Go through those, see what is being covered, see what are all of the, based on your home, and there may be some opportunities to reduce and reduce the premium by eliminating things that are unnecessary based on the status of your house. And the same applies to your vehicle. If you have a vehicle that doesn't have any sort of a lien or payment on it, and the value isn't as great because, again, they depreciate very, very rapidly, there may be some efficiencies in relooking the nature of the insurance, the automobile insurance policy. Very important is the medical, any medical supplements that you may have. If you're over 65, you are covered by Medicare. The majority of us are covered by Medicare if you're over 65. And if you have a supplement, then is that supplement, have you been able to use that, or were you able to make a claim on that policy in the last 4 or 5 years? It may be something to reevaluate to see if it's still necessary, because in the case of COVID particularly, there has been a big pullback on insurance companies and medical providers based on the anticipated experiences and losses that they are experiencing. The other insurance listed here is something called long-term care insurance. Again, as a senior, if you find yourself unable to provide, take care of yourself or provide the basics activities of daily living without some assistance, then your long-term care policy is a very valuable benefit that will prevent you from spending money otherwise reserved for other purposes for basic medical care. Now, if again you are a person that's having financial challenges, this may not be available to you based on the cost and based on the amount of benefits that you would like to obtain. However, they are available. And it is very surprising, regardless of your health situation. Again, these have to be considered because they are often a much lower alternative to having to pay these expenses out of pocket. Now, the real granddaddy or the king of insurances is the life insurance. And it's been my personal experience to find that these products can be very, very valuable if placed correctly. And Most of them are. It is a few, however, unfortunately, that tend to run out prior to the person who purchased the policy. And so it's critical that there is a meeting or some discussion similar to what I said about the homeowners or the automobile insurance, is to have a discussion with an agent. There is some agent that is assigned to that insurance policy, and that agent has a responsibility to explain to you what the policy will do and what the policy won't do. Depending on the type of policy, and I stated earlier about deaths, if you have a good solid insurance policy, that insurance policy or the benefits from those could be used to pay off any debts if you're unable to pay for them while you're living, as long as that's solid and in force. Again, depending on the policy and depending on the makeup of the policy, there could also be some valuable cash value benefits in there that could be utilized. Again, I am certainly not advising anyone to go out and do anything until you've had a discussion with the professional or someone that you can trust to help you navigate through these decisions. Again, very important that you have an explanation and you understand, or have someone explain to you in writing what this product does and what it won't do. I have just seen many, 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 many individuals who have been very surprised and pleased about the options that are available to them once they got a clear, thorough understanding of those. Now, let's go to the next slide here. And something that relevant, particularly in the black community, is legal. Legal affairs, regardless of whether you are having financial problems or whether you are not, is critical that you have a good legal plan in place and have your affairs in order, or seek help to get those in order. Now, what I've listed here are elements of your legal plan that absolutely are critical for everyone. The first that I listed, AMD, stands for an advanced medical director, because it's very common that a person may find themselves having to go to a medical facility, and if there is a important surgery or critical action that the medical professional needs to take, do you have something in writing that gives them the ability to make decisions if you can't make them? Because if you have it in writing, then you've stated what your directives are if you're incommunicative, incapacitated, and there is certain medical procedures that are needed. You certainly can't rely on a family member, because again, they can't speak for you unless they've been a court appointed or have the authority to do so. Having the medical directive eliminates all kinds of problems and saves a lot of time. Second to that is something called a power of attorney, because again, if you find yourself, you know, unable to communicate and unable to take care of yourself, who have you appointed as a trusted person that can take care of your affairs if you are unable to? Next is something called a revocable living trust. A revocable living trust is not for rich folks. A trust can be set up by virtually anyone, because what a trust does, it allows you to take your assets and your resources and put them in the name of a trust for beneficiaries or for even for yourself. And the most important thing about a trust is a trust is something that can be done and administered even when you're living. Whereas the next thing that I listed under here, which is P-O will, pour over will, is the term pour over. But a will is probably most common. The truth about a will is a will only becomes effective when you're dead. If you need something when you're alive, a will doesn't do that. And so every individual has the opportunity to seek and speak with a lawyer or a legal professional about what's right for your situation. But in concert with having your legal affairs in order, regardless of your situation, what about your final expenses? You know, it's certainly not a bad idea with your family or with your loved ones to discuss what do you want now while you're living, while you are clear mind, sound body. Hey, what sort of service do I want? What song do I want to be sang? What do I want to wear? That's a very difficult topic, and it's very difficult to have that discussion with, but it's an important one. You have that discussion not for you, but for those that are responsible for making sure that those wishes are met. It takes a lot of burden, a lot of pressure off of them if you sat down, made your wishes known, and provided that direction. So, next. So, here we are. We are seniors, but we're not dead yet. We have all kinds of contributions to make to society, all sorts. It is particularly in this area. I mentioned the Peninsula Agency on Aging, but there are all sorts of organizations, whether it's at the Veterans Administration, whether it's local, civilian, even a number of church and civic organizations, offer all sorts of opportunities for seniors to become more tech savvy. They can go out and learn about their smartphones or learn about how to manipulate their computers or the software and hardware that they use. Even to the point where a number of seniors are going back to work. And certainly you look at a department store, a grocery store or something, and you see seniors in there. And that's a great opportunity. It gives them the chance to get out, to be mobile, to network. It also gives them the opportunity to save money, and also by being able to have some sort of income coming in, that will eventually increase the Social Security benefits, because that's now income coming in that will increase those pensions if you're already receiving Social Security, because you have an income. And because the good thing about working is it allows you to potentially participate in a retirement plan. There may be a cash match, 401k, or some sort of employer plan that you can put into in a tax advantage situation to boost your income and to, again, make life easier if you find yourself having any challenges at this point. And when I mentioned the declutter and rental space, many, many seniors across this state and around the country are using their current homes as an income source for them to bring others in that can pay them rents or rent a room or use space for a purpose that the homeowner can then use as an income source. We aren't, just because a person is over 60 or 70 or even 80, how old is our president? And he's the president. There are still contributions that you can make to society. And so don't think that, hey, I'm retired and life is, nobody cares what I think. Actually, they do. I have a very good client who had been out of the workforce almost 14 years. And she decided, hey, I want to do something. And I really want to leave home. And so she actually got hired by the state of Wisconsin to do unemployment benefits. And she loves it. She comes into the office sometimes and just tell me how much she appreciates the fact that, you know, she has a camaraderie, it's helped her online skills. It's just been a very, very important and defining situation for her. And she can do it at her own pace. So, again, life isn't over for seniors. There's opportunity to get out and go back to work. But in order to go back to work, you have to maintain the stress. You have to maintain your physical health. And you have to have an attitude of service. Because, again, what my client told me is that the employer remarked of how dependable she was, how her work ethic, how he would have problems with younger employees with not having the dedication and the discipline to do what she'd done. And so, again, you have skills, whatever you have, and you can take those skills and generate income from those skills. So don't forget that. So finally, as I go to the next slide here, this is the today. It's the best day of your life. Not tomorrow, not yesterday, today. The thing that you can do, regardless of your situation, how do you react? I went to a Al Sharpton presentation a number of years ago, and he had an expression that, hey, if someone comes in front of you and they hit you and you fall onto the ground, that's on them. But if I come back next week and you're still on the ground, that's on you. So, again, no matter what the situation is, it could always be worse than what it is. So control your thoughts, seek the positivity, and consider what are the possibilities. What can I do? Who can help me to get out of this situation? And let us help. Use your resources. You have a wealth of information, experience that is invaluable. Don't belittle or don't subordinate that. Use that because, again, if there are problems, if you need help, we're here to help you. So with that, thank you for allowing me this time to spend with you. I hope that you find some of this beneficial. Certainly, if you need any help, reach out. Reach out to family. Reach out to those that you trust. And let us help you. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Joseph. And just have some follow-ups, so you stay right there for a moment. Really enjoyed the presentation, and we do apologize for the low sound that some of you all received at the beginning, but hope we got that cleared up for you and you got the gist of what was taking place. I have a couple of questions I want to share, and I think some of our individuals who are watching probably may have some of the questions too, Mr. Joseph.
Okay, great.
I saw somebody wondering what P.O. really meant again. P.O. will. What does the P and the O stand for?
Okay, excellent question. P.O. stands for pour, as in pouring.
Pouring or pour?
Yeah, pouring. Pouring out of a...
Pouring wine in a glass?
Yeah, exactly. Pour over. Pour over. Now, a pour over will is a little different from something called a simple will. A simple will, and again, I'm certainly not going to try to practice law here,
right,
but a pour-over will is an element that is normally contained inside of a trust. And so if you have a trust, and the whole idea of a trust is to avoid this thing called probate. So if your assets and your resources are put into a trust, that trust will contain something called a pour-over will that says that anything that should have not been in the trust at the point that the person who created the trust passes away, if there's something that is not in the trust that should have been in the trust, the pour over will automatically pours that asset over into the trust. So pour over will is an element, a component of a revocable living trust. You can set up this thing called a simple will that, and again, that's not uncommon. You set up a will, but a will by law has to go through probate. A trust by law does not have to go through probate.
Okay. So you pretty much, a parent can say to a son, you know, set up a will for me, this is what I want in it, so on. And you just said you don't have to get anybody to sign that outside of the house, right?
If a person sets up a will, that will to be valid, and again, I don't want to practice law, is it has to be notarized, actually. It has to be
notarized.
Witnessed. Okay. It has to be witnessed in some form so that it is valid.
It can be legitimate. So if there's no signature on the will, then it's not. Technically, it can be challenged in court.
Absolutely. It can be challenged. Absolutely. It can be contested.
Be contested. Right.
Yes.
The other question is the difference between the AMD, the Advanced Medical Director, and the POA. What is the difference, or can the same person occupy the same position?
Yes. A power of attorney extends well beyond medical. Power of attorney can extend to your property, anything, where an advanced medical directive specifically applies to your medical situation.
Okay.
For example, there are certain people who they prefer that if they are in a state where the doctor or some medical professional has determined that they can't live normal beyond a vegetative state, that they say, hey, I don't want to be revived. If I'm at that point, just keep me comfortable. Where there are others who say, no, as long as this person has breath, we want them to stay alive as long as possible. If you set up an advanced medical directive, that will respond and provide an answer to a situation like that.
And who would that be? Your doctor or somebody as a member of this association or something like that?
You're asking who would be
the advanced medical director.
Well, the advanced medical directive is actually established at the law firm or the organization up.
Okay.
Now, good question, good point though, because now if you notice, if you go for a major surgery, most medical facilities will require that you actually complete one on the spot.
Right.
For their, because again, that provides them the liability coverage if, in fact, something goes awry.
So you can avoid going to a law firm and getting all
that. That's correct. If you don't have that set up, and in some cases, even if you have one, that particular medical facility may reject that and say, well, no, we want you to sign ours as well.
Okay.
Good question. That's an excellent question.
Gotcha.
And so, but a power of attorney can go, and for those that are military affiliated, you know that if you're deploying or going away, you can actually appoint someone to take care of your belongings and take care of your situation. Good. If you're unable to do so.
Good. And for those who are 60 and over, how does the IRA and annuity work for us? I mean, not everybody that's going to, at our age of retirement, you know, have a boatload of money, or they're going to retire with a lot of money, or they've already spent their retirement money on colleges and stuff like that for their kids. So what, when it comes to the IRA, what is the point of somebody, let's say 60, taking out an IRA? Is that going to work, or would they be better off doing an annuity where some of that money can be invested and some of it given back right away? Because
sure.
I know the interest rates on the IRA is pretty low.
See, that's great. Those are great questions. And so I can speak generally, and I'll generally say this, although the correct answer is, we should look at your specific situation, because it could be valuable or beneficial based on your situation. That's the correct answer.
Right.
Generally speaking, though, when it comes to things like annuities and IRAs and investments, for that point of view, we have at First Baptist Denby, we have so many people that are over the age of 60. We have a lot of people over the age of 70, a lot of folks over the age of 80. And so, quite frankly, when I'm speaking with a client and they're 60, I tell them, look, Mr. and Mrs. Client, I'm going to work with you as if you're going to live another 30 years. Because this is very likely. Now, I know COVID and stuff like that, but still people are living a whole lot longer. And so it is generally speaking, we should take a look at a person's resources and say, well, hey, let's say you do live another 30 years. How can we help you manage your affairs so that for the first 10 years, the second 10 years, the last 10 years, because the money that you're going to spend between 60 and 70 is not going to be the same as from 80 to 90. And so the money that you need at age 80, it better be double or triple what it was when you were 60. Otherwise, it's not keeping up with the cost of living and inflation. Therefore, no, it is always appropriate. Now, an IRA, if you are over 60 and you're working, then it's absolutely a good place because of the tax advantages afforded to those. Annuities, depending on your situation and your income needs, can provide you guaranteed income.
Right.
It just, again, it's a matter of what you're trying to accomplish, what's the time frame, and where's the best place to put those dollars at that point in your life. So again, excellent question.
All right, thanks. Now, I only got a couple more because I know our seniors probably want to know this. There's some seniors who are already in debt. They are going into in retirement and they probably in tremendous debt. What are some keys to getting out? I know you said earlier the best thing to do is to review your financial situation with a trusted person who can help you do that, and as you reevaluate and go through your financial situation with that trusted person, and you find out you have a tremendous amount of debt, you're going into maybe age 70 or 72, and you have debt over your head, you're still paying a mortgage, you still have a one or two car notes. What do you do in a situation like that? Because, of course, the idea is to be debt-free when you go into retirement and not to have all that stuff. So, what advice would you give in that situation?
Yeah, it's extremely difficult to not feel judged or to be ashamed if you find your situation financially not where you want it to be. Stop it. First of all, don't be dictated to, or don't be ashamed or embarrassed by your situation, because I promise you. Whatever your situation is, I can take you to five other people that are trade places with you in a heartbeat, because their situation is a whole lot worse. Now, so that's the first thing. Get over the emotion of it, because it's just, that's the way life just isn't fair. Life isn't fair. Things don't work out always the way that we want. That's just the way life is. That's the first thing. We realize that. Now, let's be truthful and let's look at the situation, lay it out, and say, well, hey, this is what it is. Because now we have to prioritize. Well, hey, I owe this much, but I also owe this. Let's prioritize, because if you only have so much money, we can't pay everything. And unfortunately, sometimes some people just don't get paid. We have to look at your situation individually. We prioritize what are the must-haves, because I think on one of the slides I had something about things and, you know, we don't need half the stuff that we all have. And so let's take a good look. Let's take a hard look. And, you know, again, there are some creditors that they understand that a lot of the bills aren't going to get paid, or a lot of, you know, and so they have an allowance for that, you know, and sometimes they'll forgive it. And so there are solutions. It's just, again, first thing is the, what are the most important things? What are the must-haves? And then how do we work through the other ones? Because some may not get paid. And again, if it doesn't, if you got insurance, fortunately, it may pay some of those. But don't take the money that you have that you need and then give that money to someone else that gives you no benefit. Right. You can't do that. And so, no, we just, I would say, hey, first of all, get over the shame and the embarrassment, because again, most people want you to fail anyway. Everybody, yeah. You know, they don't, and so, you know, that's the way it goes. So get over that, and now let's say, how can we, what are the most important things? Let's be honest, if we have to contact someone and say, you know what, I can't make these terms, I can't do this, that's, hey, that's the way it goes. Life isn't fair.
Right, right. So do you know of any senior debt management companies out there that help seniors with that, or is that such an animal?
I will take that on as a do-out. Let me find that. I don't know anybody off the top, unfortunately, but I'm sure that there are.
Okay.
And so we just need to take a look at that, because I'm not off the top.
Okay, somebody mentioned on our thread that there's an expiration date on insurance policies, and that seniors should be aware of those expiration dates. Can you speak to that?
Oh, my goodness, if there's an expiration date, yeah, that's definitely a problem, because insurance is, you know, we certainly want life insurance policies to have no expiration date. The only expiration date should be the date that you expire, not the policy expires. And unfortunately, there are some out there that do that. Now, at the time, those were probably put in place for a temporary situation. And so if the purpose for buying that policy has been met, then those policies will expire because they were set up that way.
Okay. So if you get like a 30-year term policy.
Exactly. Then
at the end of the 30 years.
It's going to expire.
It's going to expire.
It will expire because it's set up that way. It's set up for a 30-year period. Mm-hmm. Now, some of these policies may allow you to maintain those, but the pricing is just off the charts. It gets very, very expensive.
Yeah, those are the price-driven policies, I guess.
Yes, sir.
Whole life is what they call. You buy something like that and you pay in until you, and it lasts you till you're 100? Is that
well, it
is
just, that again, that's kind of the gist of it, exactly. A whole life policy in its, the way, even in its name, is designed for your whole life. That's the whole gist of it. But again, there are all kinds of insurance policies nowadays that provide you coverage for your whole life that are now referred to as permanent policies instead of whole life policies, because a whole life policy has all sorts of special attributes and components in it that are different than other policies.
Right. So it'd be a good idea for seniors to go back, seniors, and take a look at your insurance policy.
Oh, it's
and
critical.
And see if there's an expiration date on it.
It's critical.
And if it is, you might want to re-up.
You got to look at some options, right?
Yeah, look at some other options and to take care of that.
Oh, yeah.
You've been wonderful, Mr. Joseph. I really appreciate it. Got more questions, but we're going to have you come back after COVID and do a workshop for the entire church and kind of help us with some of these questions.
Be my pleasure.
Yes, thank you. So, because there's so much to talk about when it comes to senior financing, as we're living longer, and you know, people who got early retirement at 62, you know, thinking that money's going to last them for at least 20 years, finding themselves living beyond that. And as you said, the older you get, the least your expenses become, but you still have to take care of yourself and your household or whatever it is that you might have. So. More money is going to be required as well to keep up living expenses. But I think we thank you for that, and certainly thank you for your immense wisdom and expertise in this field. And those of you online with us, I want you just, wherever you are, just give Mr. Joseph a hand and thank him. Let me get some love on our Facebook site. If you just put up some love or put the thumb up and let us know that you really appreciate Mr. Tim Joseph. Thank you again. God bless you. And we are looking forward to seeing you again in the future. Amen? All right, thank you. And so for those of you who are still watching, we are going to continue tomorrow, our last day of Seniors Week. We'll be dealing with senior lifestyles. We pray that you will enjoy us, and we pray that you will be just as immensely enriched by what we do here. Why don't you bow as we close out with a word of prayer. Father God, we thank you again for the word that was spoken. We thank you for the financial matters that can be put into place immediately for our seniors. And we pray for all of our seniors that they can govern themselves accordingly to the money, the financial and the resources that you've given them, that they be good stewards of what you've given them, and that they have good advisors and good planners and good strategies in their lives that can help them manage not only their money but time and everything else. So we thank you for them. We thank you for the caregivers. We thank you for those who have taken a leading role and being a trustworthy person to be a pot, a person of trust. And so we thank you for that, God, and we love you for it. I ask you to bless us all today as we leave this place, but never from your presence. We thank you in Jesus' name. Let all the church say amen. Amen.